Right? Everything fine?
Yes.
Bosch, you're unmuted. thank you. I heard some background noises. I worked out the solution step by step. I think it's the best way to explain it to you. Of course, there are multiple ways to do it. So the key is to solve this equation here on the top. Now the first parameter was given. That was the intensity of the focused laser beam. That was 1,000,000 watt per square meter. If you use nanometers as the units instead of meter, it would be 1 × 10^-12. The second variable was the scattering cross section. The scattering cross section could be solved by solving the Rayleigh equation as written here on the left. Let's make a nice visual laser pointer here, the Rayleigh equation. The parameters for that were the diameter 100 nanometer and 200 nanometers, the wavelength lambda 405 nanometers, and the refractive indices of water 1.23 and vesicles 1.40. And by solving it, I got a scattering cross section of 28.7 nanometers squared. It's just a sub answer for sigma s. And 1.83 × 10^3. Choosing the boundaries of the integral. We discussed it already. One thing which is which needs to be calculated first is the maximum collection angle of the lens. That can be done with the formula for the numerical aperture. The numerical aperture is the refractive index of the medium where the lens is working in times the sinus of beta, the maximum collection angle. Now, this lens has a numerical aperture of 0.60. That's quite even possible for a flow cytometer, although usually it's higher. And then if you solve the equation I got for beta, 0.15 times pi radians when you express the answer in radians, or rounded 27 degrees. For me, it's fine if you are close to this because I also rounded because the numbers are just chosen since that it's not an absolute answer.
I said that it's pi over 7. And also rounded it.
Pi over 7, yeah, that should be then close, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, pi, or, yeah, okay, no, it should be close, yeah. All right. So far, no problems, I suppose. Then the choice of the boundaries. Now, basically, we discussed it already. Here in the positive y direction, both phi and theta are a half pi or 90 degrees. But the detector is squared and it's, and by that, both, so the minimum boundaries are 90 degrees minus beta or a half pi minus beta. And the same for phi. So I came to 0.35 pi rad, or pi divided by 7. That's complicated. Pi divided by 2 minus pi divided by 7 radians to 0.65 pi rad, the same for phi, or in degrees 63 to about 117 degrees for both. All right. You could fill out the phase function p inside this integral and solve the integral. Now the boundaries are known. The integral was some constant factor times 1 plus cosine is theta. Cos theta there, and the cosinus. Oh, there is somebody typing. Everything fine.
Can anyone hear Edwin?
Okay.
No.
Nope. Did you have an expression for the value of the integral?
Actually, your internet just broke and nobody could hear you for the past, I don't know, maybe 1 minute.
You froze a little bit, okay. Edwin. So maybe you should start your slide again.
Yeah. All right. I blocked the camera again. Just a moment. This slide, right? Or the previous?
No, this one.
This one?
Oh, yeah, this one.
All right. So to solve the integral, we fill out a P into the integral. It's a constant term, 3 over 16 pi. You can take it in front of the integral. Then 1 times sine theta after integration becomes minus cosine theta. The cosine square theta times sine theta becomes minus 1/3 cosine theta to the third. You can use either a table to look up how to do that, or you can use the substitution rule for that. I used the substitution rule where I took a substitute u is cosine is x. And du is minus sinus x dx. Anyhow, how you do it, this is one way to solve it. And then if you fill out the boundaries and solve the integral over phi, which is not in the equation, I found 0.0546. Did you calculate the solution of the integral only, perhaps? Perhaps you didn't, because it's just an in-between answer. Did you find the same?
I got the same.
All right. Somebody got something else?
I also got the same.
In this case, what should trigger a bell is if the answer of this integral is higher than 1, something goes wrong. Because then, you're integrating, your answer gives, basically you're generating light there, because you cannot collect over more angles than over 4 pi, over all the angles of the unit sphere. So if you have a very unlikely high value here, like 4 or 8, then something goes wrong. Because this is basically the fraction of collected light of the unit sphere. Solution for P. So then you can basically fill out the whole integral you can solve the whole equation filling out these values which we found, and then I found for the particle of 100 nanometers and a scattering cross section of 28.7, a total power, detected power in watt of 1.6 times 10 to the minus 12 or a microwatt. It's a unit we use more often when we detect optics with a power meter. 1.6 times 10 to the minus 6. For the 200 nanometer vesicle, I found 1 times 10 to the minus 10 watt or 1 times 10, 10 to the minus 4 microwatt. Do you get something similar?
Yes.
Nice. Mm-hmm. Really good. Now the next question was to calculate what the smallest vesicle invariant would be, which you could detect with this flow cytometer. For that, you just have to change the order of solving this equation, because in this case, we set P equal to the minimum P which we can detect, the minimal power, which is 2 times 10 to the minus 5 microwatt. So all the other values stay the same. The only thing which we don't know is D in this case, to which diameter this corresponds. So we have to solve the equations of the equation here above for D when filling out the scattering cross section has. As an in-between answer, I first calculated the minimum scattering cross section that we could measure with this flow cytometer. I found 3.7 times 10 to the second nanometer squared. And that corresponds to vesicles, which have a refractive index of 1.40 with a diameter of 153 nanometers. And that would correspond to a COVID variant, so a COVID particle, which has a slightly higher refractive index because it's a denser particle with more proteins, of 140 nanometer. A very precise answer is, in reality, of course, there should be added an uncertainty to this. But for this assignment, it just shows you what you can do in this case, Rayleigh theory. What did you find?
I got the same answers as you did.
All right. Mm-hmm. Somebody got way different answers. Is there anyone who found that vesicles, smaller vesicles, could be detected than the COVID variants? No.
No, but I have a question because I couldn't follow because I made a mathematical error somewhere along the way. But the integral from 0.35 pi to 0.65 pi, the p, do we get that in front as oh, no, never mind. Okay, I got it. I know where my mathematical error was.
Okay, solving the integral is just a mathematical practice. So I prepared these slides also as a PDF. So Dirk will upload it to Canva. So if you want to revise it or check it, exactly these slides will appear on Canvas later on. So then you can check. All right. Now, of course, it was to be expected that we could detect larger, smaller COVID variants than vesicles, because the refractive index is higher, so they scatter light more efficiently. And let's continue, because the Rayleigh approximation is just an approximation for spheres, and it's only valid for small spheres compared to the wavelength of the incoming light. And obviously for vesicles, this is not always the case, because some vesicles are really within the range of the illumination wavelength or even exceed this size. So what's the reason of this? With Rayleigh, the incoming light, so the wavelength of the incoming light is much larger than the oscillators, then the electrons of the particle of which the particle consists of which yeah, which the particle contains. By this, when the particles scatter light, they do oscillate. The electrons start oscillating, and they all oscillate in phase at the same time. So there is no effect like interference, and all boundary conditions are met. But yeah, now when the particle is in the same size range as the illumination wavelength, or even a bit larger, this is not the case. One wave is traveling and propagating through the particle edge here on the left, it takes some time before this wave is there. And when those particles start oscillating, they can interfere constructively or destructively with waves generated by electrons on the other side of the particle. And of course, the boundary conditions need to be met. The wave also at the edge needs to be continuous. You cannot have a wave with a step function. This is the case, and therefore a phenomena like refraction, diffraction, and interference happen, which is much more complicated than the Rayleigh approximation. But for some specific geometries like cylinders and spheres, you can still mathematically solve this. And one way to solve it for spheres is with the B theory. And in practice, B theory solves the Maxwell's equations for scattering of light of electromagnetic radiation by spherical particles. And to do so, we typically use a computer to calculate it, because else it would be much too much work to use it in practice. B theory is valid for spheres of all diameters relative to the wavelength of light. This you have seen. Now we have access to the Mie theory. We can compare it to the Rayleigh approximation and geometrical approximation. So what you see here is a graph from Dirk, scattering cross section in micrometer squared versus the particle radius. Before I used the diameter, but of course doesn't matter. And you see that the Rayleigh approximation compared to me, which is exact, deviates from, on the log scale, let's say half the radius, or maybe up to the radius if you're happy with some error of the wavelength of light. But above that, you really should shift to me theory. For vesicles, basically we only use me theory at the moment. What is further important, when you design some optical setup, or if you do calculations for with Mie theory or even Rayleigh, don't forget about the polarization. So I try to explain that here. It's in this case, it requires a three-dimensional explanation, which is again challenging on a two-dimensional screen. But I will give it a try. So here is the particle, which contains electrons. So let's say this is one electron, and this one we illuminate with a laser beam. And most laser beams are polarized, have a polarized light. And here I draw drew the electric field component of this wave, so that this red line, it goes in fact into the screen, so along the x axis here. So if you illuminate a particle with this beam, then the electron starts, or the electrons are oscillating in this direction. And my question to you is, at which axis would you place the lens to detect light scatters from this particle? Any idea? So what would be a favorable position of a lens in order to detect signals from this particle, of which the electrons are oscillating along the x-axis efficiently? Flat, I see you're unmuted.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about this.
All right. Perhaps I should remind you a little bit of this animation which I showed you before. And this is, of course, not an oscillation. It's only a single acceleration of a schematic representation of an electron. But please note, if you play it again, oh, now my nice laser pointer is gone, that here we see this wave phenomenon, but yeah, parallel to the direction of this movement, we don't see. So these are the electric field components. And here, perpendicular to the acceleration direction of this electron, we see strongly this ripple in the electric field component, which this electron causes. But yeah, parallel to the movement of this electron, we don't see it. But that may be an important hint for my question on the slide here, slide 61.
Should it be on the x-axis then?
It's a little bit tricky because I changed the direction of the polarization. But if the electron oscillates in the direction of the x-axis, you cannot detect a light scattered from into that direction. As you suggest here, if we would place a lens there, and if it's a small lens, we would have not a signal from particles which are illuminated with a laser beam, which is polarized along the x-axis. Instead, if you would place the lens perpendicular to the polarization direction, you get a high signal. This is optimal. And of course, there are two options to do so because could be the y-axis as well as the z-axis, because they are both perpendicular to the polarization direction of the incoming light. In this case, like that. In the previous case, like this. Actually, it would not have even matter for the forward scatter direction here for the lens, which is placed at the z-axis. It wouldn't even matter how you would polarize the particle. I mean, if you would rotate the polarization direction of the laser, you would always pick up scattered light with this lens. But it has one other important disadvantage, because if you would like to use this lens to pick up forward scattered light from this particle, you also have to deal with high optical background because your laser, of course, is propagating in the same direction where you place the lens. So this lens collects a lot of background illumination from the laser. And it's very difficult to differentiate between light scattered from the particle and this usually much stronger laser light. So this is polarization independent, this configuration. But it has the disadvantage that you have high optical background. So in flow cytometers, the most sensitive scatter detector is usually a lens placed perpendicular to the incoming polarization and perpendicular to the flow, because in reality this particle also moves. Advantage of this configuration is that the laser does not propagate into your lens, so you have also low optical background. All right. On the next slide, I would like to share some examples of what you can do with the Mi calculation software. In this case, I made some print screens from the software program by a guy called Philip Laven. The software is called MiPlot. So for different particle sizes and polarization directions, we will calculate the light scattering intensity versus theta. So the particle, once again, is placed here in the middle of this unit sphere. It's illuminated from the bottom. And then we will look at how much light is scattered in the direction theta by changing, for example, the particle sizes and polarization directions. So yeah, to start off with, I simulated here, I calculated how much light is scattered of a particle with a diameter of 20 nanometers. So it's very small compared to the wavelength of the illumination, which is 405 nanometers. In this case, I calculated the perpendicular polarization. So that's the most efficient collection angle. And this particle has a refractive index of 1.50 in water. So what you can see here is that the light scattering intensity Y is equal in all directions. Now, this is what you expect from a small particles because there is no interference in the particle, there's no refraction. It's a typical, it's isotropic scattering, which is typical for Rayleigh. Now we will increase the size of the particle from 20 nanometers to 100 nanometer in diameter. And you can see the particle scatters more light in forward scattering direction and less in the back scattering direction. Please note this is a logarithmic scale, so the difference on linear scales is quite large. And this particle scatters light more efficiently in the forward scattering direction because forward scattering direction is always in phase. Because the electrons oscillate with the incoming light at the same time. So in the forward scattering direction, they're always in phase. Increasing the diameter even further, diameter 200 nanometers, you see that this the difference between forward side and back scattering direction becomes larger. So this is back scattering, this is side scattering, this is forward scattering. And to make it a bit more complicated, if we even further enlarge the particle, yeah, we get all these interference patterns inside the particle, and you get these Mie oscillations. So as you can see, scattering of particles in the order of the wavelength of light is a very complex phenomenon. Please note, once again, this is a log scale. So forward scattering direction is much, much more intense than all the sideward scattering lobes and backward scattering. Back to the initial case. So this was the small particle, which is a bit smaller than the wavelength of light, so 20 nanometers again. This is with perpendicular polarization. So you see that the particle scatters the same amount of light in all directions. But if we calculate the parallel polarization, you see that at 90 degrees, we don't pick up any light anymore, at least negligible. All right. So Mie theory is an important tool, analytical tool, which you usually use in combination with a computer to save a lot of time. You can use it to predict how particles scatter light and to understand measurements of light scattering from single spherical particles. And that's what we did in the vesicle field starting in around 2011. Just to take you back to the field, the research field of extracellular vesicles. Vesicles are small. A typical clinical, actually very clean and good clinical flow cytometer, you yourself calculated what the limit of detection is. You found that for this flow cytometer, the limit of detection was about 150 nanometers, which is okay because you can pick up this tail of extracellular vesicles in samples from patients. You would still miss the majority because this is a logarithmic scale, so most vesicles are smaller than this detection limit. Let's take a look what happened in 2008. So in 2008, flow cytometry detection of extracellular vesicles was quite a new thing, and one of the problems was that people did not know how large the vesicles were which they were measuring with the flow cytometer. So some French people came up with an idea. They said, now, let's try to calibrate the flow cytometer. And therefore, we measure 500 nanometer beads and 900 nanometer beads. Yeah, beads, yeah, that's a term which we use to generally refer to polystyrene plastic. So it's a plastic, polystyrene particles. And these particles obviously have a higher refractive index than EVs, but actually that was neglected at the time in 2008. So they measured these beads and they said, okay, we measure forward scatter and side scatter of 500 and 900 nanometer beads. And then we set a so-called gate around these beads. So those are the black lines. And then in the second measurement, we measure our vesicle sample and all the vesicles which are falling within this range, within this gate, we call EVs. Now the question is this a good idea? And I thought we need to simulate this somehow and calculate it through, because maybe this refractive index difference is very important. So around 2011, I bought polystyrene beads. You can buy them in all sizes. So I bought 200 nanometer, 400, 600, 800, 1000, and 3000 nanometer polystyrene beads. And I measured them with our own flow cytometer in the lab. So these are the measurement results. Each symbol is data. And then I used Mi Theory, taking into account the optical configuration of our flow cytometer, the wavelength, the refractive index of polystyrene. And I described this result. And as you can see, the Mi Theory describes the data very well. The R squared, so the coefficient of determination of this fit was 0.99, something like that. So yeah, showing that Mi Theory is powerful to describe optical signals of flow cytometers. Now, yeah, polystyrene beads are obviously not vesicles. And I wanted to be sure that yeah, this theory and this approach would also be valid for particles with a lower refractive index. So yeah, we also bought silica beads. Silica is just glass. Glass has a lower refractive index than polystyrene, 1.445 for these silica spheres. Again, the data points are the symbols. And then the line here is the Mi Theory, which was only off for the large bead. And it appeared that this bead was actually not solid, but contained pores due to manufacturing problems. So again, theory describes the data fairly well. Now, again, silica beads are not vesicles. Vesicles have even a lower refractive index than silica spheres. Yeah, but unfortunately, I could not buy one size of EVs because, yeah, the human body just produces all sizes of EVs, and it's very difficult to purify them and fractionate them into one size. So, yeah, I could not verify our theory, theoretical prediction of our flow cytometer with an experiment for vesicles. But, yeah, based on the... on the composition of a vesicle, which contains in reality a membrane and a cytosol, and I could look up these refractive indices of those components of the vesicles based on measurements in cells, which are basically consisting of similar materials, and calculate what the side scatter versus diameter relationship for vesicles is of the flow cytometer. As you can see, vesicle scatter light much and much less efficient than, for example, the polystyrene beads, which are previously used to calibrate flow cytometers. So we calibrated our flow cytometer not only with beads, but with beads and Mi Theory. And that's actually interesting because now we could compare the previous gate of 500 and 900 nanometer polystyrene beads to the diameter of gated vesicles. And as you can see, if you would apply this bead gate here, the bead gate which was proposed in 2008, and you say, okay, within this gate, I call every particle a vesicle, that has nothing to do with measuring vesicles because you include particles of 2 micrometers and larger. and those are cells and not vesicles. So everybody who used that at the time was not studying vesicles, but were studying, in fact, cells or other particles. So a lot of research for nothing. Another thing which you can derive from this graph is the smallest vesicle which you can detect with the flow cytometer. These smallest silica beads which we could just detect, because basically we could only detect the larger half of them, thereby depicting that this is very close to the detection limit, corresponds to a vesicle size of between 400 and 600 nanometers. So those were absolutely the smallest EVs we could detect with this flow cytometer. So a lot of information just by measuring some beads and applying MEV theory. Now, one thing was still puzzling us because, yeah, when we measured 89 nanometer silica beads, just to go back, 89 nanometer would be somewhere here where the cursor is, we could still pick up some signals. And that was very strange because, of course, based on our calibration and the MEV theory, we didn't expect that at all. And also when we took urine, which is a very rich source of vesicles, and we filtered that with a 220 nanometer filter, such that all the vesicles remaining were smaller than 220 nanometer. Then at high concentrations, we still got signals. We could still count particles. Once again, 220 nanometer vesicles would be somewhere here. So that was far beyond our expectations. So what was going on here? For that, we looked at the physical configuration of the flow cytometer and the illumination optics. And in a flow cytometer, the sample is injected by a needle into a larger flow of clean water. And this way, particles are going ideally one by one through the intersection with the laser beam. But in reality, the illumination volume was about 50 picoliters. So at a concentration of 10 billion vesicles per milliliter, we illuminated typically more than 500 vesicles simultaneously. So without dilution, if you would run a sample without dilution, you always have, by definition, more vesicles simultaneously in the laser beam of a clinical flow cytometer. Now, that's, of course, not what we want. The simple solution to this problem is just to dilute your sample. We named this phenomenon swarm detection and wrote an article about it. It was published in 2012, and we got an editorial about it. I think half of the people in the field found it really cool, and the other half really hated us by showing this, because it showed basically that a lot of research was invalid. But now, 8 years later, people are using these strategies to avoid swarm detection, so we're very happy about it. And that was the story about what we did with MEV theory in the field of extracellular vesicles. Now, to sum up this this lecture, I told you about extracellular vesicles. They are present in all body fluids. We investigate them as potential biomarkers for diseases. Indeed, as you already guessed, one of my most favorite methods is flow cytometry. Basically because it's fun to combine optical theory with the light scattering of single particles in body fluids, especially at a scale where nobody ever has looked at such particles. About light scattering itself, you have several light scattering regimes ranging from Rayleigh to MEV theory to geometrical light scattering. If you need to use light scattering, be aware in which regime you are. MEV theory is covers all, but it's not the easiest theory. So, of course, with geometric optics or Rayleigh, it's much easier to do calculations and much faster, which is important if you have to do a lot of those. In general, if you do experiments, always try to describe your data also with theory, because it gives you more understanding. If you don't, you may overlook important things, and that may lead to artifacts. And regarding optics, consider the particle refractive index, especially if you buy equipment, for example, the nanoparticle tracking analyzer, which we earlier discussed. They claimed, you can detect 10 nanometer particles with our instrument. That's entirely true, but only for gold, not for maybe the particles you want to study in the future. So if it's about single particle scattering, also think about the refractive index of your particle. And if you design some optical setup, also consider polarization. And finally, just a general message, look, think, do. So if you have a problem, don't. In the lab, maybe later on, if you do a master assignment, don't start directly doing, but also use your eyes, look, what's the problem, overthink it, and then do it. Saves you a lot of time. And those are the take-home messages of this lecture. Thank you very much for your attention. If you have further questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Thanks, Edwin. Any questions about Edwin's lecture or in general?
5 o'clock, an inhuman time.
I guess so. Well, if that's not the case, I'm at least going to stop the recording.
Yeah.